worship together.
There's no other name.
you, and we need you, and we thank you. We thank you that you sent your son to die on the cross for our sins. Aren't you glad about that, church? Amen. You know, before he left us, though, he left us with a few traditions and sacraments, and one of those we know today as communion. If you're here tonight and you've accepted Jesus as the Savior of your life, I'd like to invite you into this moment. Reach into the seat in front of you and grab those elements. It was the night before Jesus was taken to the cross. He has one last meal with his closest friends, the disciples. And while they were sitting to eat, Jesus took the bread, he broke it, explaining, "Take this and eat, for it represents my body, which was broken for you." Church, you can take and eat. God, we thank you that your body was broken, the ultimate sacrifice for one who did not deserve it, but you sacrificed it all for us. Church, in the same way, he took the cup of wine, he passed it around, and he said, "Take this," explaining that this would represent the new covenant of his blood that was poured out. You can take that element and drink as well. God, as we drink and as we eat, we do this in remembrance of your great name. For no other name can do what you did. No other name can sacrifice for the sins of the world. We thank you for it now, for that great name. I wanna be close, close to your side. Heaven is real and death is a lie. I wanna hear voices of angels above singing as one. Manna Church, thank you so much for worshiping with us. You can take your seats at this time.
Amen, amen. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, worship team. We want to say welcome to our Thursday night service. My name is Jake Johnson. I'm one of the pastoral residents here. We especially want to say welcome if you're a first-time guest. If you could do us a big favor, if you could text the word guest to the number that you see on the screen, that's going to allow us to reach out to you and connect to you on a more personal level. It's going to help us serve you better. There's also a first impressions card in the seat back in front of you. If you could do us a favor, and even while I'm talking right now, if you could just take that out and begin to fill it out. And at the end of the service, if you could give it to one of the folks in the orange shirts that say here to serve, or you could deliver it to the Connection Center at the back, we'll have a gift for you. So Manna, we don't want to embarrass any of our guests, but can we just do what we do and give them a hand? All right, if you came prepared to give today, we got a couple ways that you can do that as well. So the first way is if you text the word Manna to the number that you see on the screen, you can give via PayPal. If you'd prefer to do it the old-fashioned way with a check, you can do that too. So go ahead and you can fill your check out, and then at the end of the service, you can deposit it at one of the boxes that say give here at the back of the sanctuary. All right, so next week is baptisms. If you're interested in being baptized, please see someone at the Connection Center before you leave here today. You can also go on the app and you can register that way. We are aware also of the governor's mask mandate, so we got you covered. If at any point during the service you find yourself in need of a mask, you can also go back to the Connection Center and we've got a mask for you.
Hey, Manna family, it is that time of year. Serve Day is March 7th, and we are excited.
You know, we don't serve so that we can feel good and pat ourselves on the back.
Nosotros servimos porque Jesús nos sirvió a nosotros y nos dejó instrucciones de que hagamos lo mismo.
Outreach isn't an option. It's the heartbeat of church.
So on Sunday, March 7th, we want our communities to encounter the genuine love of Jesus, no strings attached.
Sunday morning will be business as usual with all of our normal service times across all of our locations.
But come back that Sunday afternoon to your site and team up with others as you head out for your outreach.
So there are so many opportunities for the whole family to serve in this Serve Day, like
bagging groceries,
laundromat blitz,
neighborhood cleanups,
library book giveaway,
free commercial car washes,
serving in a soup kitchen,
roadside cleanup,
recortes para los indigentes,
making hygiene kits,
delivering cookies and notes to first responders,
and many other opportunities to love the people in our community.
Ustedes saben que si este año 2020 nos enseñó algo fue...
It showed us that the church is people and the church is a force.
Manna Church, this is who we are.
We love God, we love each other, and we love the world.
March 7th, let's demonstrate His love as we serve others in practical ways.
I'm the church.
You're the church.
Together, let's be the church.
think about heaven, we often think about how to get there. When Jesus taught about heaven, he often taught about our reward there. We go to heaven based on what Jesus did for us, but our reward in heaven is based on what we do now. What you do in this life determines how you spend eternity. Max out your heavenly rewards.
All right, Manna Church, how y'all doing? That's the level of excitement I'm looking for. I gotta tell you, I look forward to these moments all through the week, getting to hang out with you guys, open up God's Word together. So I do want to welcome you, everybody who cheered loudly, even if you didn't cheer, if you're introverted and you sat back and you're just like, it's nice to be here. I want to welcome you. I also want to welcome every single one of you who is right here in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region at any one of our sites. We're all so glad. That's how you cover up not saying what you meant to say. I'm so glad that you're along with us. Also, every single person who's at any one of our micro sites could be right here in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region, around the country, around the world. We're so pumped that you're along as well, watching in a home, CrossFit gym, wherever you are, all together. Can we make them feel welcome? It's going to be a good day. This is the penultimate week, which is a fancy word to say, second to last week in our series that we're calling A Life That God Rewards. And I have got to tell you that your eternal reward is our passion. My prayer for every single one of us, every single one of you, is that these words that Paul wrote right at the end of his life, I'm going to read them in a moment, but Paul's in Mamertine prison, and these really are his final words, his final entreaties. There are several more verses after the verses I'm going to read where he has some personal greetings, but the last thing he gets to say to encourage us to follow after God, to seek him with everything that we have are these. My prayer is that these words are going to be true for every one of you. He says of himself, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me. This is what I want for you. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day. Then he reaches out, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Jesus wants this for every single one of us, for every single one of you. He wants to give you a tremendous reward. And Paul, who penned these words, knew so clearly, we can see it even in his writing, that we go to heaven based on what Jesus did for us on the cross, but our reward in heaven is based on what we do in this life with what he gave us. And over the last weeks, we've been talking about living a life that God rewards, and we've been answering the question, what does God reward? To me, that seems to be the fundamental question. If God's going to reward us for eternity, the Greek words that he uses for reward are epididymi, which means repay. If God's going to repay us for eternity, another Greek word is misthos, it means wages. If God's going to give us eternal wages that last forever, what do we need to do in this life to earn those wages so that that repayment will come? We've talked about six things so far. I think when we study the scripture, we'll see seven things that God promises he'll reward. So far, we've talked about these six. And I've told you for several weeks now that the most important is the first one. I think we get this right. If we devote ourselves to this, then we'll probably walk into every single one of the rest. And that is seeking him. Seeking God with all of your heart and responding to him, following him, listening and moving to based on what he nudges us to do, what he leads us to do. Then there's faithful stewardship in your earthly work, which I think is great news. We spend so much time at work, and if we'll work at our work in a way that honors God, he says, you know what? I will reward you. There's denying self. Anybody's going to come after me, Jesus said, he must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. It's putting God first, his ways, not my ways. There's service all throughout Scripture. God talks about serving, and he promises if we'll serve, we'll serve in his name. If we'll serve him and others to honor him, he'll reward us for that. There's suffering in his name. The Scripture tells us rejoice and be glad when you suffer. I don't want to feel like rejoicing and being glad when I suffer. And yet, why does it tell us to do that? Because God is going to reward us when we walk and we follow him. God's not going to waste the pain that we walk through in this life. He'll reward us in eternity. And then there's sacrifice, willingly accepting loss for his name. And those are the six we've discussed thus far. And today I want to talk about one more word that starts with S, and that is sharing. But really what I mean by sharing is generous investment in the kingdom of God. Generosity, investing in the kingdom of God. Now, speaking of generosity, I was in a small group. I hope everybody's in a small group. At every single one of our sites, the micro sites, you need to be in a small group. And probably if we've been in a small group, we've had that experience where, you know, whatever the topic of our small group is, it could be bowling. But somewhere in our small group, we're talking, I'm just saying, could be bowling. I'm not picking on you. I'm telling your group. If you want to bowl, this guy right here, he's there. He's going to take you bowling. I'm not picking on you. It could be growth track. That's right. You leave growth track too, don't you? It could be boss. Three fans. Okay. You got that topic that you're going to discuss, but then you branch into other topics. That happened to anybody? You're just over there and you're doing your thing. Hey, let's talk about this. So I was in a small group and we're having a discussion on generosity. And I don't know if you've been in a small group and you realize that somebody really wants to share. Anybody know what I'm talking about there? Like all of a sudden their behavior changes. They're like, oh man, I can't. You go, Bob, share. So he goes, okay, I've got a story to share. Not quite like that. That's me. He's more sedate. I've got a story to share about generosity. He said, last week, I was going to the mall, and at the mall, I encountered a lady, and she was just weeping. She was crying. So I went up to her, and I asked her. I said, hey, why are you crying? And she says, I just lost $200. As soon as I heard her say that, I knew what I should do. I reached in my pocket and I pulled out $40 of the $200 I found at the entrance and I gave it to her. Hashtag blessed to be a blessing. Hashtag freely I receive, freely I give. I knew what God wanted from me in that moment. Some of that blessing's meant for her. That's what I thought too. Well, yeah, take your time. Recover. Pass the tissues. I titled the message today, Send Ahead What You Can't Take With You. And in that title, I think there's a truth. I know there's a message for every single one of us. There's a powerful truth that I hope that I pray that we'll capture with this idea. Send ahead what you can't take with you. But before I explore that, before I jump into what the Bible says on that idea, let me start with a question. Which of the following scenarios represents smart money, wise money decisions? There's an old lady who came into church with $2. And she wanted to drop those $2 in the box at the back. Say, hey, I'm gonna come in and I'm gonna drop these off. And so in conversation, we discovered that's all that she had. There's the only $2 to her name. She didn't know where her next meal was gonna come from, but she says, I feel like I should drop this off in the box. And so the question there is, should she, in fact, drop that in the box, or should she use that $2 to try and get some food? She doesn't know where her next meal's coming from, to try and do something for herself. Same day, there was a guy who was a farmer, and his farm was exploding in a good way. So he'd had a massive crop, larger than any crop that he'd had before, and he realized that the crop was larger than the silos that he had. And so he thought, you know what? Here's what I'll do. I will tear down the silos that I've got. I'll build new, larger silos. That way I can store all that crop. I'll make my profit bigger. It will be a blessing. It'll be great for me. So the question is, should he rebuild the silos? Say, Fletch, there's a trap here. I know there's a trap, but it seems like I know what the right answer should be. Seems logical. We know what the Bible would say, right? Luke 21, verse 1 says this, as Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. In reality, it's the smallest monetary measure they had at that point. Truly, I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on. Luke 12:16-21 says this, and Jesus told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest, and he thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I'll store up my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you've prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God. See, obviously, I took those stories from the Bible and changed them slightly, and it seems counterintuitive. It seems most logical that the lady should use the last bit that she has to take the next step that she needs. Whatever is the next thing that she needs, she should try to do her best to get that with what she has. And yet, God commends her. Jesus commends her for generosity, the type of generosity he would say she should be rewarded for eternally. And the farmer looks like he's making a smart choice. He's trying to take care of this crop and preserve the future and what's coming. But Jesus is drawing the distinction between investing, spending, stockpiling for this short life versus investing, spending, stockpiling for eternity. Also, come back to this idea. But before I move on from it, notice about the widow. It wasn't about how much she gave. Scripture tells us others were giving greater gifts. It was about what she had. Generosity, hear me now, generosity is not measured by comparison. So that's what we're tempted to do. Okay, this gift is bigger. This person gave this much. This person did this much. This person sacrificed this much of their time. This is how they did this. This is how they did that. But in reality, generosity is all about what you do with what you have been given. Now, before you get concerned, say, Fletcher, are you preaching a message where we should just take everything that we have and give it away all of the time? I'm not preaching that message. In fact, as we talk about money, I would encourage you, if you've not heard, to go back right at the end of the year. Last year, we finished with almost to the end of the year, we did a series called Right on the Money. And we talked about what the Bible says about money because it says so many things. We talked about saving and investing and diversifying in our investing and our work and how we should approach that and what we do with money. In fact, I think of Proverbs 13:22, a good person or a wise person leaves an inheritance for their children's children, but a sinner's wealth is stored up for the righteous. So saving is a good thing. Leaving an inheritance and a heritage of inheritance, not just here, but beyond, to the grandkids, as scripture says. That's what a wise man does. What we need, and this is what I want to illustrate, and then we'll dive into some ideas. What we need is an eternal or a kingdom perspective on money. And money is a big topic in the Bible. There's 2,300 verses, a little over actually, 2,300 verses that deal with money or possessions. And there's a huge connection with reward. I think Jesus demonstrates this so clearly in the Sermon on the Mount. One of the cornerstone, preeminent passages on money in the scripture we find in Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 24. I'm going to walk through each of these verses, but I'm just going to go quickly through the first several verses because I want to go back and almost look line by line at some statements that Jesus makes. So Matthew 6, 19 through about 21 goes a little, I'm going to paraphrase as I quote, but basically it says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust, I think NIV is where moths or vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moths nor vermin destroy and thieves do not break in and steal, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So that's the passage. We'll add a couple verses at the end, but let me go through that a little bit more slowly and make some commentary. I think that God would insert our hearts as into our hearts as we study. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth. This is stuff. This is what we chase. I think a lot of times when we read a verse like this, we find it so easy to excuse ourselves because we tend to think of this passage talking about the frivolous things. Just like, oh yeah, you know, the ridiculous stuff that people waste money on. But for a lot of us, these treasures are good things that are out of order. What could I put in this? Don't start for yourselves treasures on earth. That could be your dream house. That's not one of those things that we generally think of as a problem for us. We go, no, I mean, I'm going to work hard and I'm going to make decisions based on putting everything that I can into place in the right time, in the right way, based on what I have, not overextending myself too much to get my dream house or my dream car or this vacation that I absolutely have to have. Sometimes we screw ourselves up there. I've got to make this happen. Even if I've got to use my credit card and I don't have the, I'll make this happen. Or I've got to save this much for retirement. Or I want to be at this exact place in my savings account. I'm not saying any of those things are bad on their surface. And I'm not saying that God doesn't have any one of those things for you in this life. I'll say it in a moment, but I'll go ahead and say it now. The question is, do those treasures that all of us want, that sometimes all of us chase, do those treasures have us or do we have them? Who's in control? Who's making us make our... I'll tell you. See, here's the reality. There are some places where God is calling us to be generous, but we find ourselves unable to be generous because all of our resources are tied up in the treasures we're chasing. Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. The reality is that stuff could be gone in this life in a moment. We all know that's true. And at the same time, all of our possessions on earth will burn. No matter how hard we chased it, what we gave up for it, how much we sacrificed for it, it will not make it to heaven with us. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. How do I store up for myself treasures in heaven? Based on what you do in this life with what you've been given. In this context, and specifically, your money and the possessions you have in this life. Where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. Here's the reality. Treasure stored in heaven is eternal. It lasts forever, and it can't be used up. You're not going to get to heaven and find your treasure and go, you know what? Spending spree! And wake up the next day, I don't have anything left. No, it's going to last. In fact, in that context, treasure stored in heaven is bad decision proof. Because all of us have made some bad decisions with some cash. Come on, tell the truth. Be like, man, I did so good. I got more than I expected. And then you're like, that car was a bad choice. Anybody ever spent years trying to justify back to a spouse why it wasn't actually a bad choice? No, honey, remember this? It was good. It never worked. Why do you always got to look at the bad side of things? Should be more positive. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. This is what it's all about. I said it before, I'll say it again. Do you have your money or does it have you? I think the point Jesus is making is send ahead what you can't take with you. I'm going to pick on the idea of a dream house for a second because I want to tell you something that I think is fantastic. God has a dream house for you. We'll see this even more next, well, a little bit later. For every single one of us, God has a dream house in eternity. That's his plan for you. For some of us, his plan may be that you have a dream house on earth as well. And associated with that is probably a lot else that he has planned for that house. Marriages getting put back together. People coming to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Maybe hosting a small group here or there, or parenting kids, or spending time on your knees, pouring out your heart before him. There's probably a lot associated with the dream house God literally has for some of us in this life. But I'm telling you right now, far beyond your greatest imagination, God has a plan for you to have some amazing things in eternity. But I'm gonna be clear. Our experience of those things, our reward in heaven, is based on what we do in this life with what we have been given. He has treasure for you, repayment, wages, based on what we've been given, what we do with what we've been given. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body is full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? He's talking about what we see. The question is, do we see the kingdom way? Do we see the way that Jesus sees? I'll be clear. There are rich and poor in this life. And there will be rich and poor in heaven. What does that look like, Fletch? Come next week and I'll explain it to you. How rich you are in this life does not determine how rich you'll be in heaven. And how poor you are in this life doesn't make an impact on how poor you will be in heaven. What you do with what you've been given in this life, and yes, your money specifically, will determine how rich you are in eternity. Or another way of putting it, how generous you are on earth impacts how wealthy you will be eternally. I want to have a kingdom perspective. To be honest, that's what I want for you too. That's what I pray for you, is that we together, as a group and as individuals, won't waste X amount of time. And I said that on purpose, X amount of time, because the truth is, I don't know how long you have. I don't know how long I have. I know for each one of us, it's appointed unto man or woman once to die, and after that, the judgment. I don't know how much time we have, but I promise you, I do not want to waste it living for something I can get on this life. I want to live for eternal wealth, for eternal reward. No one can serve two masters. He says, this is the point. You will live for reward. I don't know if you realize that or not. In fact, you're already living for a reward. Every person here is living for a reward. One of two ways. Either I'm living to reward myself in this temporal life, or I'm living to be rewarded eternally by God. No one can serve two masters. Either you'll hate the one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. In Luke chapter 16, if you got your Bible, I'd encourage you to go ahead and turn there. I'm going to spend just a little bit of time there, about 15 verses. Jesus told a parable that can be confusing, but I think it's helpful if we'll look at it from a certain perspective. I think it's helpful in understanding an eternal perspective on how we use our resources in this life for eternity in heaven. Verse 1 says this, Jesus told his disciples, there was a rich man whose manager And really, we should think they're steward. And we should understand that a steward has the responsibility. He's been given the management of a household. And so it's his job to make sure everybody has the food that they need, and the master's money is put out the right way, and everything happens for his estate, etc., properly. And so he's going to deal with other people, and he's going to take care of their accounts and what they owe and provide, etc. And so that's kind of his job. He's been trusted with the master's possessions and stuff to work for his master. There was a rich man whose master, or his manager, his steward, was accused of wasting his possessions. And he, the master, called him in and asked him, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you can't be manager any longer." The manager said to himself, "What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses." So he called in each of his master's debtors, and he asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" He said, 900 gallons of olive oil," he replied. The manager told him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked the second, "How much do you owe?" 1,000 bushels of wheat," he replied. He told him, "Take your bill, make it 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he'd acted shrewdly. I don't know about you, but I read through the Bible, and I read through our Bible reading plan, and I get to Luke 16, and I read this parable, and I'm like, this is a little confusing. And I get to that spot, and I go, what is going on here? Anybody else with me on that? It's like, why is he being commended? This does not seem like ethical behavior. This isn't smart. I think probably the better question is, what is he trying to show us here? I think we'll see it as we continue. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of light. I tell you, Jesus is speaking, I'm telling you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves. That's generosity. Use the resources, the money that you have to gain friends, be generous, so that when it's gone, you'll be welcomed into eternal dwellings. See, this parable can be a tough one to understand, but I think we can apply it this way. I think this is the point he's really trying to make. We don't need to miss a moment. So the steward acted quickly because he knew his time as a steward would be over in a moment. Anybody get where I'm going here? Because the reality is all of us are stewards. And this time that we have to steward what we've been given goes by very quickly. This life won't last forever. And the steward in this story, he realizes, you know what? Tomorrow, none of the merchants who work with me will want anything to do with me because I'm no longer in charge of what my master has given me. But today, since I'm in charge, I can work something out with them. So he comes in and says, hey, cut it in half. Tomorrow, they're going to remember him and appreciate his generosity. We shouldn't be dishonest. That's not what he's saying. What he is saying is, when the moment is gone, when this life is over, when you're no longer the steward, you don't get to go back and use the resources you've been entrusted. It's over. I think it's amazing also that he points out, hey, look, take what you've got. Take your resources. Take your money now and use it to gain friends so that you can be welcomed, notice what the verse says, into eternal dwellings. You cannot take with you possessions. You cannot take cash with you. It's going to burn. What you can take with you is the impact you've made in people's lives. It says, bless people here, they'll welcome you into their eternal dwellings, into their dream house in heaven. Fletch, you made an impact in my life on earth. Come on in. We have a relationship. Is this making sense to you? We only have today to use what God has given us for the sake of the kingdom, to win friends, to honor God and others, to be generous. Then he continues, whoever can be trusted with very little can be trusted with much. Don't wait to be generous. For you can have much, you got to be trustworthy with little. See, some people have the perspective, you know what? When I get wealthy, then I'll be generous. If that's your heart perspective, you won't. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. If you've not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you've not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No one can serve two masters. Sounds just like Matthew. Either you will hate the one and love the other, you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. And then Luke captures one other thing, and I think this is so interesting. And I love so much Jesus' heart, because Luke captures how the Pharisees respond. See, they could not see money from a kingdom perspective. It was only about them and what they could have in life. And sometimes we're guilty of the same thing. Sometimes all of us tend to live for me and now and what I hope to get. And Jesus wants so much more from us. The Pharisees who love money heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. He'd already said everything that needed to be said. He'd already taught the principle. We could study it and understand it. But Jesus pauses, and he does not need to turn around and say anything else. But he does. He said to them, "You are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others, but God knows your heart. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight." Now, if I said that, it'd be with a sneer. Pharisees sneer at me. Oh, yeah, you guys don't know anything. That's never been Jesus. So you think, I think Jesus looks at them and loves them. And I think Jesus looks at us all the way through time and knows we're all guilty of the same attitude. Whatever, God, I want me first, not other people first. I want me first, not what you say first. No. You understand. I really need this thing. I really want this thing. And Jesus is saying, guys, see it the right way. He wasn't thumbing his nose at them. Jesus wants to reward you. He wants you to be wise with what you have been given. He's trying to help us see there's a much greater investment to chase. You can see Jesus' heart so perfectly in John chapter 14. This is where he encourages his disciples. He says this, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms." I'm reading the NIV. If I read in the KJV, the King James Version, and the NKJV, you know how they translate that word? My Father's house has many mansions. You know what another word for mansions is? Dream house. "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many mansions, many rooms, many dream houses. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." What a wonderful reality. Jesus made a way for me. He has a plan for me. He has a place for me. Same thing is true for you too. Money's a tough subject. It tries to hold a mastery in our lives, but Jesus has so much more for us. Our best life, the best way we can live, is living his way. Send ahead what you can't take with you. Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Even as you bow your head to pray, I want you to notice there wasn't a lot in this message where I said, okay, here's what you need to do. Because this is one of those places where we really need to seek God. Lord, what do you want for me? What do you want me to chase? Where do you want me to put my resources? Where do you want my money to go? Teach me to be generous. It's not about what anybody else does. It's about what God is calling you to do with what He gave you. Lord, I pray for every single one of us. Lord, I pray that You'd give us ears to hear and eyes to see what You want from us. I know, Lord, that You are looking to reward us. And one of the ways in which You're looking to reward us is based on how we use what You've given us, what You've given us to steward, to advance Your kingdom, to honor Your name. So Lord, I pray that we would be people who respond to You. I pray that we would be people who bless in Your name, who are generous in Your name. I pray for every single person here that they would hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." In Jesus' name, amen. If you keep your heads bowed for just one more moment, for just one more prayer. I love that verse at the end. Jesus is encouraging His disciples, and He's encouraging them because not too long after this, He's going to go to a cross and die. Part of what He's explaining to them is this is the end of His life on earth, and then He's going to go and He's going to make a place for them. He's making a place for every single one of us. But in going to the cross and dying, before He made a place for us, He made a way for us. Because all of us are separated from God by sin, and there's no way we could make a way on our own. We can't get back to God. We can't be righteous before God on our own. We can't give enough. We can't come to church enough. We can't be kind enough. We can't say enough nice things. No, sin will always separate us. So the way that Jesus made a way is He lived a perfect life, fully God, fully man, died a perfect death. 3 days later, He rose from the dead and offers us an exchange. If we'll repent of our sins, if we'll put our trust in Jesus as our Lord, then He'll forgive us our sins and He'll open the door to heaven where He's made a place for us. So if you're here at this site or at any single one of our sites and say, "You know what, Jonathan? That's what I need to do today. I need to ask Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. I need to put my trust in Him. I'm tired of trying to do it my way. I need Jesus' way." If that's you, then we would love to pray with you. I or your site pastor, we're standing by, and we would love to pray with you right now. We're not going to embarrass you, but we would like to ask you to do one simple thing. We'd like to ask you to do it right now. If you say, "That's me, and I want to pray to make Jesus my Lord and Savior," at this site and in every site right now, I want to ask you to raise your hand. All across this room, just slip your hand up high. Say, "That's me. I'm ready to put my trust in Jesus. I want Him to be my Lord and Savior." I ask you to put your hand up high, one, so that I can see it. That's the primary reason. I want to know who it is that I'm praying with. And if you put your hand up or you wish that you did, there's a little packet in the seat back in front of you that says, "I raised my hand." When we're done praying in just a moment, I'd invite you to take that packet, fill the white card out that's inside the packet. Then you can leave that little white card on your seat or give it to anybody who's wearing a Here to Serve shirt or a Here to Serve lanyard. We'd love to get a hold of you and help you as you journey with Jesus. We won't bother you, but we do want to see how we can help you. The little packet is yours to take home. So if that's you, go ahead and slip your hand up high. If you've been waiting, before I missed you, just give me a wave. And then in a moment, we're going to pray aloud together. I'm going to pray out loud. I'm going to ask every person in the room to pray out loud and join after me, praying along with those, making Jesus their Lord and Savior. All together, "Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I pray that You would cleanse me. Make me right with God. I'm ready to put my trust in You. I put my faith in You. You are my Lord. You are my Savior. From this moment forward, I'm going to follow You forever. In Jesus' name, amen." Amen. Let's put our hands together for anybody to pray that prayer for the first time.